My name is Max Cameron, and on behalf of the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions, I'd like to welcome you to an evening with the Right Honorable Paul Martin, the 21st Prime Minister of Canada. But before we begin the program, I'd like to ask Wade Grant to offer us a few words of welcome on behalf of the Musqueam people on whose ancestral land we currently stand.
Thank you very much. My name is Wade Grant. My traditional name is Tsal Akwalano. I represent the Musqueam community whose territory we stand on today, and I thank you for acknowledging and recognizing that this is unceded territory of the Musqueam people. I'm also an alumni of the University of British Columbia, a political science graduate, so I'm very glad to be here tonight. And I think it's very, very fitting that we stand here in the Museum of Anthropology amongst all of these great pieces of artwork, these artifacts of people from up and down the coast of British Columbia, because we did have our own system of government. We had our own system where we would choose our leaders, not democratically, where we would go and vote. We didn't have ballot boxes and those sorts of things, of course, but we would choose them by who best represented our families. And I think it's an opportunity for us to come in together and really honor that society. But I wanted to thank you all for asking me to come here tonight to welcome you to Musqueam. It's very fitting, of course, that we're near the Fraser River, because for thousands of years, for over 5,000 years, the Musqueam people have welcomed people. They'd asked them to come here, come to our territory, come to our longhouses, come and learn, come and sit with us, have a meal with us, learn about the history and the culture, learn about the language, learn about our families. And we didn't have a written language, so we would ask them to witness that. We would ask them to be witnesses, to take that information for which they had come to learn, take it back to their families, take it back to their communities, so that they could pass it on. And so I just think that I look at each and every one of you, and I look at you as witnesses to witness with the work that's going to be done here tonight with my friend Paul Martin and Ian Hanomansing, and over the next few days, take the information that you take today and bring it back, share it with your family, share it with your friends, because that's how we educate, how we've educated our people since time immemorial. And I thank the university for recognizing that as well. And I also wanted to talk a little bit about the subject matter that we are here to talk about today. I'm an elected counselor for the Musqueam Indian Band. I've been on council since 2004, and I wanted to tell the Honorable Paul Martin that if you think it's tough to be grilled by Stephen Harper in question period, you should try coming down to the reserve and being grilled by your aunt because some dog crapped on her yard. But I wanted to thank you all, and I thank you for recognizing our territory, and I thank the university for always reaching out to the Musqueam people. 50, 60 years ago, my grandfather wouldn't have even imagined that I would be standing here as an equal, as a person that would be a graduate of the University of British Columbia. He wasn't allowed to go to university unless he gave up his status. He wasn't allowed to vote in the democracy we call Canada. Now today I'm here, standing here with the former Prime Minister, with former premiers, with former ministers, and I really look up to each and every one of you, and I hope that as we move forward, we create an even better society, not only for First Nations, not only for Vancouverites, but for all of Canada. So I thank you all again. I hope you enjoy your time. Thank you.
I just can't resist saying that the Department of Political Science has extraordinary alumni all over the province doing amazing things and all over the country and all over the world. So thank you very much for that wait. It gives me enormous pleasure to introduce and to welcome to UBC the Right Honorable Paul Martin. Paul Martin is Minister of Finance between 1993 and 2002. Played an instrumental role in eliminating deficits in this country that have been built up over decades before and in virtually wiping out Canada's debt. He was also credited for strengthening Canada's banking system, and today Canada is seen as a model of sound and prudent financial regulation. Mr. Martin has been very much in the news in recent days and weeks. He's spoken out on Aboriginal education, on the Occupy movement, on financial turmoil and other and environmental issues and environmental resources. And he's just back from a trip to Africa, where he's working on issues of poverty and sustainable development. So it's fitting that tonight he chose as the topic for the discussion, leadership and public policy in a challenging global world. And we look forward to hearing his characteristically global and forward-looking perspective on these issues as how they and how they relate to democracy in Canada. We're also joined at the podium by Ian Hanomansing, who is familiar to all of you from CBC's The National and CBC News World, a veteran reporter who's covered the Exxon Valdez spill, the riots in LA, Stanley Cup riots. We hope there are no riots this weekend while you're in town, Mr. Martin, as well as Olympic Games. Ian's a hockey fan and has covered hockey in late night CBC television programs. I know him as a debater, and he is one of the most formidable debaters that this country has ever produced. He's been recently covering the Occupy Vancouver movement and has a very strong interest in the strength of Canada's public institutions. We'll let Ian start the conversation, and then we'll open the floor for discussion. And at that point, I'll ask a graduate student in political science, David Mosscrop, to come up and to explain the different ways that you can participate in the discussion, through tweeting, through texting, or through simply the old-fashioned way of grabbing a mic and shouting out your question. And remember, this is just the beginning. We'll wrap up tonight at 9:30, but then we'll start again tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock in Robson Square. We have an exciting program with a group of very influential Canadians who will be looking at why more good people don't go into politics. And throughout these 2 days, we hope to develop for the Center for the Study of Democratic Institutions an agenda for publicly engaged research and teaching. We want to take a positive and constructive but unflinching look at what is wrong and what is right with Canadian democracy. So I'd now like to call on Ian Hanomansing to begin the discussion. Over to you.
Very much, Max, and welcome everybody here tonight. When Max called me a few months ago, probably, and asked me to moderate this session and be involved in this conference, I agreed very quickly for three reasons. First of all, he and I represented New Brunswick at the High School Debating Championships 32 years ago, Max. And so I owed him a favor. So that was number one. Number two is this topic of political engagement is one that I heard people speak so passionately about here on campus just a short while ago. It's one that I think probably all of you care about, which is why you're here. And as a journalist, it's one that both I care about and I'm frustrated by what I see as a lack of engagement. So I'm happy to play a small role in this evening. But the third reason I agreed to do this is the most important one. There are probably not a lot of countries in the world where a former head of government can come here not surrounded by a lot of security guards, not having to worry about a discussion, a public discussion devolving into some kind of partisan shouting. I think we can have a great conversation today. It's about engagement, it's about your engagement, it's about getting other people engaged. And so it's really important that we hear from you. And in a few minutes, you'll hear from one of the graduate students here, David, how you can tweet, because I can see some of you ready to tweet already. There'll also be a microphone where you can ask short questions and not give speeches so we can get lots of people involved here. And Mr. Martin, and I'm trying to pretend that this is really cool, like I talk to former prime ministers all the time. I may actually take a picture of you surreptitiously on my BlackBerry and tweet it at any moment. But Mr. Martin, the one bit of advice he gave me was no holes barred. Ask any question you want, push back, let's have a good, creative, interesting discussion. And so keep that in mind because we'd like to hear from many of you very quickly. But let me start, Mr. Martin, with the question that's on the poster, which is why don't we have more people, good people, involved in politics?
Well, before answering your question, I'd just like to thank, I want to thank Wade for welcoming us on behalf of the Musqueam Nation. I really, Max, I want to thank Max Cameron, I want to thank the university for giving me the opportunity to engage in this discussion with Ian. I've got to say to you, I'm delighted to be up here with Ian. He's interviewed me 5 times. Not once has it appeared on television. I simply have to tell you, I mean, this museum is just spectacular. I mean, to walk down there, I mean, to stand up there and to look down this way is a sight that is really something to behold. I'm not sure that you and I add to it, but it's spectacular.
Classic politician not answering the question. No, I'm just kidding.
Classic 73-year-old, I can't remember him.
So why don't, and I'm trying to, the syntax sounds bad, but why don't more good people get involved in politics?
I think actually, I'm not sure I agree with the premise. I think that there are every bit as many good people trying to get involved in politics. I'm not sure that they all get elected, and I think that's part of the problem. I think that part of the problem exists within the nomination process within our political parties. And also, I think the other part of it is that sometimes good people tend to think that they don't have to go through some of the difficult processes to get involved. Let me just give you sort of one example of the way it ought to happen. Justin Trudeau, who for obvious reasons would have been a catch, and obviously it was a catch for the Liberal Party, was offered the nomination in Montreal on a platter. And he said, no, I'm going to run for the nomination. And it took him a year to a year and a half in Montreal, where he went out and he made sure that he got the delegates who would come and vote for him. Part of the problem, I think, is a lot of good people think that they should simply be they should be appointed. And that is that's an issue, because in fact, if you're talking about democracy, then obviously the primary system is part of that. The other thing I think as well, and there are some issues here. One of them, I think, that the process or the fact of negative advertising a lot of people just simply do not want to go in and see their reputations absolutely destroyed before they've even had a chance to stand on a podium. I think that is a real problem. I think the other thing is, I think we make a mistake in judging some people as being good or bad depending upon how they stand on the issues. Let me tell you that we are all going to debate. We're going to debate issues tonight. But you know, if the issue happens to be, do we build a bridge or not? Ultimately, it is the politician that has to decide whether you're going to build that bridge. And what that really means, if opinion's 50-50, and he decides to build a bridge or she decides to build a bridge, that the 50% of the people who didn't want to build that bridge are going to think he's not very good. And that's what's going to happen, because they finally have to, the politicians are the ones that have to make the decision. I actually don't believe that we had the quality of the people who are running for public life or who want to run for public life today has deteriorated. I think that there is a problem getting them into office.
Who should be running for public office?
Oh, I think that I think most of the people in this audience should be running for public office, and I can tell you the party too. I think anybody who has strong convictions, who really does want to offer himself or herself to the country, I think that person should run. Because I will tell you something, I have been in politics and out of politics. If you get into office and into government, you can do more in 5 minutes in government than you can do in 5 months outside of government. And I think that if what you want to do is to accomplish things along those lines, you should run for public office.
Who shouldn't run as a candidate?
Oh, people who basically think that this is, well, people for whom it's the best job they can get, or people who really are sort of enamored seeing their picture in the paper.
They can be TV reporters.
Well, yeah, they shouldn't run. No, I think it really depends on your convictions. If there are things you want to do, if you believe in the positive role of government, you should run. If you don't believe the government has a positive role, and I have a lot of trouble with people who sort of say, I don't think government can do anything, I'm gonna run, it doesn't make any sense to me. Why would you wanna run to do nothing? But if you believe that government has a positive role to play, then you should run.
So some of the things that I hear as a reporter out on the street every day talking to people that makes them maybe reluctant to run or cynical about politics generally, there are a bunch of things, but one of them is they feel that their MP ends up being swallowed up by a government and can't continue to represent his or her region or constituents properly.
Look, the fact is that to a certain extent, you have got to have party discipline. A budget has to pass, and you've got there are going to be non-confidence motions. And when you have a non-confidence motion, you have got to support the government. Do I think that we have taken non-confidence motions far too far? Absolutely. And I said this when I was in office. Anne McClellan is here, and we discussed this a great deal. I think that essentially we should have far more free votes, and that the government should not fall when it loses a vote unless it has deemed, or the opposition has deemed, it a confidence motion. And that would give politicians by far more ability to basically judge their votes on the basis of their own conscience and their own perspective.
Some people blame the media, the pundits, the people who want sound bites, reporters like me, for oversimplifying things, being too quick to jump on gaffes or what we think are gaffes. To what extent is that a problem?
Oh, I think you guys are a terrible problem. I just think that's a bum rap. I think that the press does its job. The one thing that I would say, however, is that there is a certain cynicism that is bred sometimes in political reporting. Again, Mike Harcourt is here, and Anne, and a number of people who've been involved in the political process. Fundamentally, most governments try to make the right decision. They obviously are conscious of the political ramifications of their decision, but they nonetheless try to make the right decision. And then they'll go out and they'll try to spin it in a way that'll make it politically palatable. But the fact is that most analysis that comes only deals with the political side and does not deal with the policy that they're trying to debate. And there are huge differences of opinion on many of these issues. And I think that if there was a fairer reporting, a more in-depth reporting of the issues, as opposed to simply the political spin, I think it would be better. I think that we as politicians, we damage ourselves. I mean, I'm sure you've all watched Question Period. I mean, it is the classic thing. You don't want to watch sausage being made. I used to talk to my father about this. He used to say that the debates in the House of Commons were tremendous debates at one time, and Question Period really didn't count until he started televising Question Period. And then all of a sudden, that became the only thing that people looked. And I can tell you that politicians, the way we all are, Anne McClellan and I used to sit in the House of Commons, the House of Commons, the people are yelling, they're getting going, you stand up, by God, testosterone is... takes over, and as she would say, and then you would go home, and the only people who ever watch Question Period are people who are retired, at least in my riding. And I would go back, I would go in, and I would be full of myself, and they'd look at me as if I was some kind of dredged up from the sewers. The problem is that Question Period is not government at work. Question Period is really bad theater, and government at work is much different. And if people, I think, saw what MPs did, I think that they would have a much better stature, much better perspective from Canadians.
Speaking of sound bites, I'm sure many of you are eager to get your, 138 character tweets to us. So David, a graduate student, is here, and he's going to come up to the microphone and explain how you can get in touch with him by Twitter or other media. David?
Good evening. So, we're going to leverage the digital age tonight in this audience, inspired, by the way, by Sam Sullivan's Public Salon, in which we were allowed to use our cell phones, and we all got really excited, because usually we're told to shut off our cell phones as we're chased off people's lawns and that kind of thing. But if you could turn your ringers off, please, that way, as Sam reminded us during his, because nobody wants to hear a cucaracha while Mr. Earth is trying to respond to a question. So we have a few options for you tonight as we leverage the digital age. We have text message. On your cards, you have a text number, a cell phone number, 778-869-2327. You can text us at any time during the night, and we'll take the questions. Twitter, 140 characters, so the deepest, most substantive questions you can find in 140 characters, please do send them along. Hashtag WhyPolitics, at UBC Democracy. Also, follow us. Yes, there's a lot of Twitter opinion makers out there. We'd love to have you as part of our followers. Interpretive dance, if you're feeling up for it. Just hop in the aisle, give it a go. That's a go. Also, we'll be having, as mentioned, audience questions, so you can put up your hand, and we have a few people coming around with microphones who actually come to you. It's a full-service evening. And also, we're going to have these cards. So, if you'd like to fill out the cards and pass them along, we've got two people who will be coming along, just put them up in the air. We'll come by and grab them, and we're going to filter as many through as we can, group them together, and then Charlotte here throughout the night is going to ask. I'll just add one little caveat. In the spirit of democracy and openness tonight, we'd like you to keep your questions brief, thoughtful, and respectful. So.
So,
see where I'm going with this. If you're looking for a guideline, imagine what a member of parliament during question period might do, and then do the opposite. Sound good? So thank you very much for joining us tonight as we, as I said, leverage the digital age and enjoy the rest of the conversation. Thank you.
Great, thank you, David. And you can stand up when you have some stuff, and then I'll know to come to you with, you know, just sort of stand up where you are and I'll know to do that. So any tweet that starts OMGPM will be perfect. We'll make sure that we... So we were, you were talking before we came here about your father, Paul Martin Sr., and how, if I understood it correctly, he was a, you felt sometimes that he was a far more beloved figure upon retirement than he was when he was in power. And you were saying that to you that that kind of suggests that the idea of the good old days when politicians were respected, maybe even revered, might be a slightly romantic view.
Well, yeah, I think that. Look, do I think that the situation, that there is greater degree of cynicism today? Absolutely. And do I think that we have problems with the way that politicians are regarded? Do I think we have problems with sometimes the way that politicians act? Absolutely. But to sort of say that we could hearken back to the good old days, to use your expression, when politicians were highly respected and beloved, I just don't believe those good old days ever existed. I remember my father, who today is he's passed away, but is very much revered, very much respected. Well, when you were his son and carried his name in Windsor, Ontario, that was not the perspective. I think that we tend to glorify what was. I think that the politicians have always had a problem, and part of it is that. In many ways, politicians either are not going to act or they have to act in a way that people don't want them to. And they're the ones who have to, and that's what they're being elected for. And so people object to it.
So some of the irritants that I hear people talk about, fairly perhaps, maybe unfairly sometimes, is that some politicians say things during an election campaign and then do the complete opposite even just months later. And that really infuriates people.
Yes, that does happen.
So what do we do about that?
Well, I think that obviously you take your option at the ballot box the next election. I mean, if it happens too often, obviously it's going to reflect on that politician. Also, circumstances can change. Circumstances can change, and under those circumstances, clearly you've got to recognize it. I think that there has to be a flexibility, but given the example exactly the way that you gave it, and I suspect I know what you're talking about. I think that's unfortunate that that shouldn't happen. But I can tell you, the other side, you know, where people in the Tea Party in the United States get elected on one thing: I will not increase taxes, regardless what, in a country that absolutely has to increase taxes. And then to find yourself bound not by your own conscience, but that you cannot be flexible on that issue makes no sense either.
Lots of potential answers to this. You don't have to answer it with every bit of complexity, but just whatever top of mind comes to mind. What would you suggest we all do, the system does, your party does, to get people more engaged in 2011?
Well, I think that that fundamentally what has to happen is, it, given obviously the state in which my party happens to, right now, is that we have an enormous amount of rebuilding, and we've got to be in the process of doing that rebuilding. I think it's happening. I think that in terms of getting people elected, the idea of somebody getting a nomination 6 weeks before the election just is not on, and we should be in the process of somewhere 2 years out, 2.5 years out, we should be nominating people, and they've got to get out and they've got to get known. When I first ran, I started working that riding a year and a half before I was I got the nomination. I wasn't going to take the nomination from the party. I was going to fight for it, and I went out and did that. I don't have a great belief in the so-called star candidate. I think that you're far better off to get people who've gotten their feet a little dirty and they've actually tried to learn the process. I don't think star candidates are actually very well known. When I first ran, I was supposed to be a star candidate. I think half the riding thought I was my father.
Name recognition doesn't hurt. I think we have some tweets or input of some sort.
For our first question through text message today, we have, do you think Canadians have different concepts of good politicians based on local, municipal, provincial, and federal levels? If so, what's the catalyst for this? And if not, why such great differences between political spectrums in these areas?
The question being, do people have a different perspective on a municipal versus a federal versus a politician, a provincial politician?
Yes.
Yes, I think they absolutely do. I think that mostly that. I think that really has a lot to do with the city, and I think it has a lot to do with the province. I think it's probably different. I would probably, having run in Montreal, should speak about where I come from. The provincial politician in Montreal is, in the public mind, a more important person than is the federal politician in many ways. But overwhelmingly, in terms of public concern, the municipal politician is the one that gets the most interest. Nobody ever woke me up in the middle of the night to complain about snow removal. But the municipal politicians, by far, were the public face of the political life, and were much better known within the riding, not so much by name, but by actually what they did to deliver. I think that oftentimes, if you ask what is the difference between a provincial politician and a federal politician, what do you deliver? I don't think people really understand the difference.
And for those of you who think that David's voice just changed, that's a different graduate student who asked that question. I'm going to throw out a few things to you that I asked some people at work. What do they hear in terms of what the public feels solutions are to political problems? And I'll throw some of them out to you and you tell me what you think. One of them is the Australian model. People are dismayed by low voter turnout, so do what the Australians do and make voting mandatory.
No, I don't think that works. And I think the people, you'll get a multitude of spoiled ballots. And essentially, if people, you want people to vote because they thought about it and they're concerned with it. And what we really want to do is to raise that level of concern, but I don't think mandatory voting works.
So how do you get more people to vote, or are you dismayed? I know so many are, by what they perceive as low voter turnout.
Well, I think it's the quality of debate, and I think the quality of debate in the country becomes very, very important. And I think that there are a number of ways in which this is going to work. Number one, I think the politicians have got to present their arguments. And I think the politicians have got to deal with these policy issues in a much more open and a much more transparent way. I think your profession has to report on them. And I think that there has got to be much better analysis of the policy debates, not just the policy spin that is out there. And then I think the third, and I think this is really important, I think that civil society has got to be supported. I think that what's happening at the present time with the cutting back on the funding of civil society is a major dagger in the heart of democracy, because it means that those people who are going to go out and analyze the issues and publicize those issues, are not going to be doing their job. And I think that what you're seeing, I'll just give you one example, the fact I feel very strongly about overseas development aid. Kairos, which is the Council of the Churches, has had its funding cut by the government, eliminated by the government. Well, that means there's a major voice out there that is going to be talking about overseas aid and what has to be done. And I think that, NGOs, civil society, play a huge role. Max was talking a little bit about Africa. I spend a lot of time in Africa. One of the things that is being done in Africa is tremendous emphasis to get NGOs in Africa to be able to play a voice, to have a voice in the African debate in order to get perhaps the Arab Spring taking place a little bit lower in the sub-Saharan Africa.
A question from the floor.
Thank you. Maybe as a supplementary to Ian's question about when a politician gets elected, sometimes a short time after they do something completely different and something that can cause cynicism in a constituency or among the electorate in general, crossing the floor. I was wondering what opinion you might have on whether or not that does damage to the whole process when a politician, especially soon after an election, crosses the floor from one party to another.
Well, again, you people are certainly subtle. Actually, no, I don't think it does. I think that if you're thinking about the same case I am, I wasn't very happy about it, but I had huge respect for David Emerson, I wish he hadn't done it, but I believe that his motivation was pretty clear, and I don't think it hurts them.
He is a very impressive guy. I've dealt with him as a reporter in many of his jobs. I also happen to live in that riding, and I heard a lot of people who talked about feeling betrayed, and they felt that they had voted for a Liberal candidate, and they wanted a Liberal MP, and he crossed the floor shortly after. And you know, I think that was not a minority view, that sense of betrayal.
Yeah, I understand that. And all I'm saying is that I don't think that on any of these issues you can have blanket rules. I was very disappointed when he did that, but I don't think that he did it for personal gain or anything like this. I think that he did it because he believed that was the right thing to do. I wished he hadn't done it, but I think that this is one of those cases that does not damage it. I think that politicians who cross the floor for reasons where the motivation is pretty not is. Is either very clear or unclear, I think, then it does hurt the political process.
But, you know, some people came up with what it seemed to me to be a very elegant solution, which is if you feel so compelled by an issue to cross the floor, then that MP ought to contest a by-election and say in that by-election, I am now a candidate for whomever, and take it to the people.
Except that we've had a tradition for a long time that, in fact, you can do that and you face the people at your next election. That's the way the tradition has been built up. These are the one of the kinds of things, I guess, in which reasonable people can differ. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that it would be necessary to do that.
Go to our Twitter and text desk.
We do. So we have a direct tweet in response that asks, what about Belinda Stronach? Do you still agree with her floor crossing? And if we could just ask for you to speak up just a little more, we're still having some difficulty in the back.
The issue is very, very much the same. She had a very clear reason. She disagreed fundamentally with her party. She disagreed with her party in terms of on a number of substantial issues. And so she crossed. And I think, in fact, again, it comes down to the reason that you have done it. I mean, the answer to your question is I have no difficulty with Belinda Stronach having done that. And I have even greater ease talking about it.
When we go to questions on the from the floor, just quickly in a line or two identify who you are and then ask your question, sir.
Yes, I would like to know what is the definition of good people? Good people, in my opinion, I might have one opinion about good people and somebody else might have other opinion, because good people doesn't have a definition. If I'm anti-war, for example, I might be a good people in opinion some people and some people know. This is one question. And other question is, I think people don't get engaged because in Canada there is not much differences between the parties. Their policies are very similar, so people say it doesn't matter if I vote for this person or that person, result will be same. So I think maybe that's the one reason. What do you think?
I think that the differences, I think that certainly between the liberal, I think the differences between the liberals and the conservatives today are greater than they have ever been, certainly in my political life, at any time I can remember. I don't think that, I think that anybody who thinks that there is a blurring of the lines between the two parties is badly judging the philosophical basis upon which both parties would operate today. And I don't think you want me to get into it, but...
Well, you can, absolutely.
Well, if we've got 4 hours, I'll go... No.
Okay, that'll be the post, that'll be the after party. We have seven or eight seats up front, so if people are in the back and can't hear, because there's not much more we can do in terms of speaking more loudly, please come up while we're talking, and there are at least seven, maybe nine seats here. So this is a good time to come up, and then in terms of the people with the microphones, I can see when someone's here, but other than that, I just need a clear, do you have a question from the floor, okay?
I'm Irene Giesbrecht, and I'm a career counselor. My clients are in their 20s and 30s, and they've got degrees on their walls. Lots of them know that they want to be a politician coming right out of the gate. So what's your advice to them? Do they need to go through a detour, through another career? Or can they become a career politician?
Well, first
and
of all...
And if so,
yep, sorry.
Which, and if so, which detour?
Well, first of all, you know, on all of these things, there are no hard and fast rules. I'll give you an opinion, and it's an opinion which I think is certainly advice that I would give to any young person, and I would suspect that it would probably apply to 60 to 70% of them, but there are 20 or 30% for which this advice would not be the right thing. My father first ran and was elected at the age of 32 and was in public life all his life. I would not recommend that to a young person. I think that you're given 20 years in which you can really make a difference, and that you should, that 20 years should be after you have gained a period of experience somewhere else before you go in. In other words, And I think that this idea of becoming a career politician, there's no reason why you cannot have a career in politics for 20 years after having had a career somewhere else. But I think that you've got to bring something more to the table than simply raw youth in order to really understand and to really focus on the issues that have to be dealt with. The second thing is that I would, on a practical basis, I would say that if you're going to have to worry about money, and you're going to be always on the knife's edge, then for heaven's sakes, don't run. When you go into public life, you don't have to have a lot of money, but you have to have something that you can fall back on, a career or a set of experience that you can fall back on. You do not want to find yourself defeated at the age of 40 with no experience of any other kind except having been a politician, because life is pretty tough on the people who do that.
Thank you. We have a question from the floor to my left here.
It is on. Okay, Mike, I want to shift the... Philip Resnick's my name. I teach in the political science department here. It's in part as a former minister of finance, I'm addressing this question to you, and in relationship also to the 1%, 99% we've been hearing about more and more in recent months. And my question is the following. Does democratic politics still matter when the rating agencies like Moody's, which themselves have contributed fulsomely to the current international crisis, have been bringing down one government after the other in Europe? What remains, really, of democratic politics in this era?
Well, I'm going to answer your question, and I'm going to use it to branch into what I think is a slightly different avenue. So forgive me if my answer is a little bit longer than it should be. I do not believe that, let's use the markets as opposed to the rating agencies. I do not believe that the actions of markets in essentially driving a country's bonds up and making them so too expensive for a company to be able to afford, which is such as what has happened in the case of Greece, Portugal, Spain, and Italy. I do not believe that is anti-democratic at all. I think that, first of all, let's understand who the markets are. The markets are every one of us in this room. They are pension funds, they are insurance companies, and they are the banks that we bank with, and they are making a judgment on the fiscal management of that particular country. I don't think that is anti-democratic at all. I think that what has happened in the case of these countries is that it's simply bad economic management has had to pay a penalty. Now, if I can, however, go to the next part, because I think your question is really a very important one. We are here talking about Canadian democracy, and so we should. But I think what we also have got to understand is that our economy is now so globally integrated that the definition of a sovereign economy no longer exists in the way that it has been traditionally interpreted. The fact of the matter is that in 1995, we as Canada had to act on the deficit, because if we had not acted, and the next time that there was a financial crisis occurred, the fact that we were paying 36 cents out of every single dollar was going to service the national debt, we would have been within 2 years where Greece is today. So effectively, we took charge of that and we dealt with it before the crisis hit. And I think that's what a government is supposed to do. A government is essentially supposed to govern, to run its country on a basis that is economically sound. The market, it happens to be part of the global world into which we live. And there is no alternative to that market, because if you're borrowing instead of raising taxes. And if the choice is, and I think that there's a level of borrowing which is justified. Now, if you don't want to be part of the markets, then raise your taxes up that high, and you'll find that your country will no longer be competitive, and in fact, you won't be able to operate. Because the world in which we operate, no government can tax its people sufficiently to build its roads, to build its universities. You have to be able to go into the markets. That's not a judgment call on democracy, that's a judgment call on globalization as we have it now. But what it really means is that integration in the world is not only markets. It is immigration. It is climate change. The fact is, it is actions taken by one country affect the climate of another. If we have rains today and drought tomorrow, it's because something has happened that has occurred in a multitude of other countries. There is now today no decision that could be taken almost by any country that is not going to have a contagious effect on its neighbors. And that's the nature of the world in which we live in. Now, you can say, I don't like that world. Well, that's too bad. You should have been born prior to Sumer 5,000 years ago. I mean, the fact of the matter is, that is the nature of the world in which we operate. The problem is that the great democracies, because this is a problem primarily of the great democracies, because we've been the richest countries, have not built the global institutions that will allow us to govern that kind of a world. So when we talk about our democracy and we talk about whether politicians are loved or not loved or whether they're going to deal with these issues, one of the issues we really should ask is, are politicians building the kinds of international institutions that, in fact, with which sovereignty is going to be shared, so the kinds of problems that you just raised aren't going to happen? And that's why, to be quite honest, Canada created the G20. And let me just give you the background. I'm sorry for going so long, but I really think this is an important issue. We were in real trouble, as we all know, in the middle 1990s. We brought down the budget that dealt with the deficit. My biggest fear was that there would be a financial crisis before we could get that job done. And in fact, 2 months before we brought down the 95 budget, the Mexican peso crisis hit us, and our interest rates went through the roof. Fortunately, it was of short duration. They went down, we brought in the budget, we dealt with the issue. 2 years later, the Asian financial crisis hit, everybody's interest rates went through the roof except ours, because we had dealt with that particular crisis. We've now just come through the worst financial crisis since the Depression. There are institutions, the Financial Stability Board, the Canadian, Mark Carney has just been named ahead of it, which is essentially going to say we're not going to be able to regulate the banks on a national basis any longer. They have to be regulated globally. That is an institution to which we are going to have to delegate our sovereignty over bank regulation if we're going to make the global system work. The same thing for climate change. So when we talk about our democracy and when we talk about what our politicians are doing, more and more I believe that we should be judging them by the role they play internationally and by the institutions they build internationally. That is a very different ballgame than one any of us have really had to deal with.
I'm sorry, I can't find a soundbite in that, so I'll just have to ignore it. Let's go to our digital desk.
We have a tweet here from Alex Pensato who asks, how can power in the Prime Minister's office and other central agencies be lessened to levels present before Trudeau took office?
Two ways. Parliamentary reform, number one. It goes back to this issue of not every vote has to be a confidence vote. Parliamentary committees have got to be strengthened. And parliamentary officers have got to be strengthened. I mean, the appointment of Kevin Page, who is basically is to provide the numbers to Parliament so that Parliament can judge whether the numbers it's getting from the government make sense, that was a very good innovation. You've got to give the parliamentary committees the power to do their job, which they don't have. The second thing is individual government departments, and Anne could speak to this as well, have got to be given much more policy capacity than what they had now. What really happened to, and this began with Mr. Trudeau actually, what really happened is that in fact policy making capacity was taken away from the individual departments and was centered in the Privy Council office. And the only department that did not lose its policy-making capacity was the Department of Finance. And thank God it didn't, because we never would have been able to do what we did in 1995 if it had lost its policy-making capacity. But government didn't evolve. And let me just give you one example of what I mean. What happened in the Department of Foreign Affairs, at one time Foreign Affairs governed all of the foreign affairs, the foreign policy of the country. But somewhere in the 80s and 90s, and it got more and more, all of a sudden the Department of the Environment, which was a domestic department, ended up spending half its time on international issues, climate change. And when I was the Minister of Finance, I spent 40% of my time on things like the G20, which was all international. All of these government departments suddenly had their own foreign policy thrusts. And so what happened is that foreign affairs suddenly found itself denuded, and then the Prime Minister got himself a foreign affairs advisor, which basically did the job. So I think what you've got to do is we're going to have to start building back policy into the departments so that in fact there are these alternative voices as opposed to only one voice, which is the one that comes out of the Prime Minister's office.
Thanks. We still have two or three chairs in the front row here, and I'm going to take a question from the floor, and while the question is being asked, do feel free, two or three of you, to come and sit just where I'm pointing over here. Yes.
Hi, thank you. My name is Catherine Evans, and I'll just describe myself as someone who's involved deeply in civil society. You were just a moment ago describing the nature of the complexity of the world that we live in, and I reflect that you also mentioned the Tea Party, and I recently have been watching Ken Burns' series on prohibition. Our system seems to favor single issue ideas. We are able to drive a wedge in our own Canadian politics on issues like the gun registry.
if we're in a world that requires complex thinking and people to make decisions on a broad range of issues, how can we work with a system that favors such single issue agendas?
Well, I think that those people who really who understand that the world is not is not simply one single issue a day have got to make the argument that you just made. I mean, the essence of the parliamentary system, and we know the great debate that took place 200 years ago in England was the debate between, do I represent my constituents, the views of my constituents, without thinking any further, or do I say to my constituents, you have elected me for my judgment? Parliaments work when you vote for people who are chosen for their judgment. And you've got to make that, you have to make that argument. And if in fact the single issue is going to defeat you, and that's what's going to happen, then eventually your democracy is going to get into the kinds of trouble that Ian is talking about, and eventually people will get fed up with it. The parliamentary system, our democracy says that you have an idea and I have a different idea, and we will debate it out, we will have it out. And unless you're prepared to have it out, then in fact, you're not going to succeed. And the best example of that, and it's easier to talk about somebody else's problems, I mean, that is the problem of the Republican Party in the United States. It's not a problem of a democracy, it's a problem the Republican Party has essentially allowed itself to be taken over by, 25 to 30% of single issue people. And democracy can't function on that basis.
Do you have a follow-up, or is that, a different person there? Okay, and then we'll come over here.
Thank you for coming. My name's Claire McGovern. I study political science at UBC. I wanted to ask how governments go about balancing the long term with the short term. So presumably you come into office with a set of priorities, but then events happen, things you can't foresee, public opinion shifts, splits within parties. How did you as a prime minister, did you manage to stay focused on what your priorities were, or did you feel yourself being pulled about all over the place?
Look, there are going to be short-term issues which you have to deal with, and they are certainly going to be the issues, the stuff of headlines, and you have to deal with them. But if that is the only thing you deal with, you're going to fail. Successful governments actually bring down policies, the benefits of which 9 times out of 10 you're not going to see for a decade. And it's really only after you've gone along by that you see it. If what you're doing is, if you're governing for tomorrow's headline and that's the only thing that you do, I don't think you're going to be a successful government, just simply because the time it takes for things to work out. And governments are capable of doing that. And this goes back to one of the debates that we have in our democracy. Goes back to this issue of the public service and the importance of the public service. And let me give you an example of what I mean. After we had dealt with the deficit, the Canada Pension Plan was underfunded by a greater amount than the national debt. And it was Canada Pension Plan is joint, federal-provincial. And after we did our budget, we had a lot of provinces in the country that were pretty unhappy with us, with me. And I called the ministers of finance of the provinces, and I said, look, we're all cutting, we're all going through this, let's deal with the virtual bankruptcy of the Canada Pension Plan, let's make it right. And this is something that finance ministers had been putting off for about 20 odd years, and the finance ministers of the country, Liberal, NDP and Conservative, all reacted and said, yes, let's do that. And what this was a group of people who basically said, look, we're not going to get any credit for this. We're not going to get credit for this for 15 years. It was a magic moment. And we did it. We did it. And that it was done because they looked ahead 10 years. If they had looked ahead 6 months, they wouldn't have done it, because we all got crucified at the point, because we were hiking premiums on the one hand, and we were cutting benefits. Now, I want to go back to the public service thing, because when you talk about democracy, you can't just talk about the elected. You've got to talk about the quality of the public service. The reason that we are also able to succeed in doing that is there were public servants in every province and at the national level who understood the issue of the Canada Pension Plan. They had the institutional memory. All they were waiting for was the politicians to say, let's do it. And they did it, and it worked. No, quite clearly, if you're looking for tomorrow's headline, go find another job. If you're looking to be a footnote in somebody else's history book, then probably you should run.
I think we have a question from here.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Ian Bruce, and I work with the David Suzuki Foundation. One of the things you just mentioned actually was collaboration, seeing politicians from all different stripes working together to achieve something. And I think too much today we see parties oppose good policy just to take partisan advantage. And the gun registry probably was a good example of that. But my question is on electoral reform and whether you see changes to Canada's system. For example, proportional representation that was put forward here in British Columbia, but did not obviously go through. But looking to see more incentives in our political system for politicians to actually collaborate and work together to pass good policy, and your thoughts on that.
Well, I think the other, I suspect you support proportional representation. And one of the things you got to do when you're a politician is tell somebody you don't agree. I would stay with first past the post. I think it works. I think the reason for proportional representation is that we're not getting enough women running, and this does provide you with a way of getting of naming candidates the way they do in a number of other countries. I would really hope that we could. I would really hope that we could make first past the post work and still increase the number of women candidates.
How do you do that?
Well, I think that then this is where you begin to essentially say we're going to take the democratic process, the primary process, only so far, and leaders have just simply got to be prepared to name.
Isn't that some kind of failure, though, at this point, that the system itself just can't produce enough good female candidates, that the party leader would have to actually appoint people in 2011? Like, why aren't we getting more better women candidates, female candidates?
Well, the fact is that we are at the provincial level, where we are certainly at the municipal level, we are in the NGOs. Yes, your question is this a failure of our system? Yes, it is. Do we have to? But if you're saying to me, well, if the only way you can rectify it is not nominate them, are you not recognizing another failure? And I'd say, well, look, I think this is the better way of getting women candidates, and I think it's by nominating them.
We certainly have some people in the audience, who are female politicians, others who maybe aspire to that, who may want to weigh in on that. Let's go to the digital desk for a comment or two.
All right, so through text we have this question. What do you think of Harper's halfway measures of electing senators? Is it the best way to get good people into the Senate? And how would you deal with reforming the Senate?
Well, let's be realistic. You cannot change the number of senators named per province, appointed per province, without a sufficient number of provinces supporting it that it would get it through. And given the fact that Ontario and Quebec have 20 to 25 senators apiece, that Prince Edward Island has almost as many senators as some of the much larger provinces, it is hard for me to see how you're going to get provincial approval to reducing the number of senators or on some proportional basis. The question comes down to, would I elect senators that would essentially say that smaller provinces with smaller populations will have more senators than larger provinces with larger populations, and they would have the legitimacy of election? The answer is I don't think it's a very good idea. I think it would bring absolute chaos within our system.
We have a question down here.
Just a follow-up to the first-past-the-post question. The way we elect MPs, do you think we could preserve the first-past-the-post system by switching to something similar to how we elect leaders of political parties with a runoff ballot? And in that way, we make sure that a leader always has, or somebody elected always gets 50% plus one as a percentage of the vote.
Well, I think it's worthwhile. I think it might be worthwhile looking at if that were necessary to, because I do believe we have a problem with, you know, interest in people voting. If that would do it, then I would say, yeah, I think it's something that we might well take a look at.
So we're into our last half hour now, so here's the opportunity. What I find often when we have conversations like this, or you know, any sort of group, that people towards the end really have this burning desire to get their question in. So while we still have some time, make sure you make your question known to the people with the microphones, and we have a question right now.
Hi, first of all, thanks for making the time for us here. Just back to the Senate reform question, if you don't believe that the current proposal for elected senators is legitimate, would you, given the choice, abolish the Senate, or would you try to have the Constitutional Conference, and in the event of wrangling between the provinces where you couldn't get agreement on seats, go above the provinces with a pitch of your own directly to the people and say, would you want a referendum on this type of a Senate, and try to get that passed? How would you deal with the situation?
I think that Senate reform along that basis would be so divisive. I think it would be so divisive in the country that I just don't think it would be worth undertaking it. I got to tell you something. I don't go to bed at night dreaming of the Senate. I think the Senate does really good work. I think there's the Senate did a report about a year ago on Aboriginal issues, which was a tremendous report, which far better than anything has come out of the House of Commons. I think there is really good work that is done in the Senate. I think we've got a lot of issues we have to deal with it, as a country. I think this issue of how we're going to make the world work right now is a far more important issue than this one. I think how we are essentially going to start providing jobs to the 18 to 24 year olds, how we're going to basically give ourselves a reasonable manufacturing base. I think these are issues on which the country should focus at the present time. I certainly would not go to seek reforming the Senate in the middle, following what I think is probably going to be not only the worst financial crisis, but one that's going to last for another 4 to 5 years. I think that's the priority.
You mentioned the Senate report on Aboriginal issues. We're surrounded by reminders of Aboriginal culture. You were very impressed by your tour that you and Anne had through the museum a little earlier. And you're keenly interested in First Nations issues. What about that relates to our topic of politics, governance, political engagement?
About 10 minutes ago, in response to the question on the financial crisis and the markets dominating, and I talked about the need to build global institutions, and I said that this, in my opinion, is the major democratic issue that we, because it has everything to do with the country's sovereignty, that we are going to face going ahead, and that we better start to understand this, and the rest of the world better start to understand it. There is a second issue. This is not one that goes beyond our borders. This is one that we deal with within our borders. And it was very interesting to hear Wade when he stood up and made his opening remarks. So let me just, again, an epistle that won't give you an eight second soundbite. The Aboriginal population in Canada, and I don't have to tell the people in British Columbia this, it is 1.2 million. It is the fastest growing and the youngest segment of our population. I don't think I have to go into the fact that it also has the highest levels of infant mortality and the shortest life expectancy. As Wade said, in fact, when he made his opening remarks, he basically said that the Aboriginal people had governed ourselves since time immemorial, before the settlers got here, and it worked pretty well. And he said it was not the form of democracy that we have, that it was a different form. I've tried desperately in this whole thing not to be partisan. So I hope you will bear with me on this. 2 days ago, the Minister of Indian Affairs, Mr. Duncan, came out and said that the government's priority is to deal is to have transparent legislation dealing with the salaries paid to tribal leaders. Now, let me just deal with this. Nobody that I know disagrees that salaries that are paid to tribal leaders should not be open and transparent. The Assembly of First Nations has said that these salaries should be open and transparent. At the time of the Kelowna Accord, the AFN essentially said that they wanted to work with the government in order to improve accountability, and they wanted openness and transparency, and they wanted to work on a basis with it that it would be done. And the government walked away from the Kelowna Accord. They have asked for an Aboriginal Auditor General, and they met with the Auditor General in order to set that up, and the government has refused to move on it. The issue that we are now facing is we have a country in which we have a million two Canadians who are receiving education, the cost per capita which is 20 to 30% lower than the cost per capita of the education of non-Aboriginal Canadians, and the effect is being seen. The work in terms of governance, and if you want to see something, Jody Wilson-Raybould, who was the regional chief of the AFN here in British Columbia, has come up with a set of documents that I can tell you I have read. Now, I have seen everything that Ottawa has ever produced on this, and I was there at the time. Here in British Columbia, they have produced the best set of documents on governance that I have ever seen, of Aboriginal governance, far superior to anything that exists in Ottawa. And I believe that what we've got to do within this country, just as we have to do it without this country, when you're talking about democracy, is to understand that the inherent right of self-government for Aboriginal Canadians is here. It's there, and it's not going to change. And that the efforts out of assimilation have failed, thank God. And that what we should be working about in terms of our democracy is how do we not impose democracy on the First Nations, the Métis Nation, or the Inuit, but how do we essentially work in partnership with them so that in fact the youngest and the most vulnerable segment of our society is able to grasp the same opportunities that any one of us are. That's a democratic issue. And the First Nations leadership is saying, I want to work with you on this. I want to work with you on this. I want to work with you on education. And I've got to tell you that when government continues to say, we're going to impose this on you, when they're saying, for God's sake, we want to do this, work with us on it, it is wrong. It is wrong. And I think that is a democratic failure. And I think we should deal with it. And I really cannot tell you how strongly I feel. The issues that Ian has been asking, that you have been asking, are really important issues. The cynicism that exists within the country, the failure of good people to get themselves into office, a country of our wealth in which we should be playing a far more important leadership role within the world. These are very important issues. But if we are not prepared to understand that as 34 million people in a world of countries over a billion people, so integrated into that economy that we have got to take a leadership role in making that world work. And if we're not going to, and if we're going to turn our back on the single biggest democratic issue when the Aboriginal leadership are asking us to work with them on it, then I think there's something is fundamentally wrong with our democracy. It's because we're not recognizing where, in fact, our priorities lie.
Let's go to our digital desk again to hear some tweets or texts.
In a tweet we have, does negative advertising work in Canadian politics? And can we ever go back to a time before negative advertising?
Yes, unfortunately, negative advertising does work. I think it's one of the main reasons that we have the situation that Ian described at the beginning and that a number of you called for. I think it badly damages the political process. I think that, you know, when a government runs on my opponent is no good, as opposed to this is what I'm going to do, it can't help but basically drive a dagger into the heart of democracy. But if the question is, does it work? Yes, it does, and that's why people do it.
We have a question from the back of the room, I think, or wherever the microphone is. Just one sec, so if we can turn on the mic where I'm pointing over here. Okay, try again, sir.
Hi, my name's Rick Cook. I'm interested in Canada's role in Africa. And I had the experience firsthand to enjoy being in Kenya last year when, right after they'd adopted their new constitution, and I saw it firsthand in the rural areas, what it meant for people. Do you see hope in other parts of Africa for that kind of democratic reform?
Yeah, but not fast enough. You know, one of the things that happens when you're prime minister, or when you step down voluntarily or not, is that everybody thinks you, you know, my God, you're a prime minister, you must know everybody who counts in the world. And you do for about 6 months. And what you suddenly find is that, Tony Blair has stepped down, he's no longer the prime minister, or Gordon Brown is defeated, George Bush, all of the people that I knew have now stepped down. They're all like me, on pogey. But I got to tell you, I spent a lot of time in Africa. And I know everybody because they were there 20 years before I became prime minister, and they're going to be there 20 years after. But things are really changing. Things are changing. I mean, I think your comment about Kenya was a tragedy. I mean, this was one of the fastest growing, one of the best, most solid countries, and they just threw it into a trash can in the way in which they operated. It's getting better. I think that Ghana was a real breakthrough. I think that when the government was defeated, the former leader stepped down, and it worked in the way that it did. I think that it was a major step forward. And in fact, the democracy is winning. It's a much more slower process than we would have wanted to see. Good luck, Jonathan, in Nigeria. There was a lot of problems. There's a lot of problems in the country, some problems in the election, but it was generally held to be an honest election. I think that it's improving, and I think it's absolutely crucial that it does.
We're going to try to jam as many questions from the floor as we can in our remaining 10 minutes or maybe 9 minutes. And is there somebody with a microphone there? Somebody will come to you, but let's just see. Is anyone else close to one of the microphones we have on the floor? No? Okay, so you're going to run up and give this woman an opportunity to ask a question right there.
I have a question regarding Singapore. I was there last year, and it seems that their economy is functioning well, and also it's functioning very well in Sweden, which is a different country and different politics. And I would like comments and also a question to you. Why newspapers and news do not report more positive examples that are happening in the world in other countries, but Greece, Italy, Portugal are every day in the papers?
I'll be happy to talk to you afterwards. I don't want to take the time away from the former prime minister because you can hear from me.
I'm not sure I understand.
So go ahead. I'm sorry.
The first question.
Yeah. So in terms of Singapore and Sweden, what do you want to know about it?
Yes, they do, but for very different reasons. I mean, this is Singapore is a small island state that's been managed to basically reach out to a lot of countries which have not handled their government as well as Singapore, and I think that's going to be there for a long time. A very authoritarian democracy compared to Sweden. But I'd like to know, Ian, why can't the media do a better job at doing whatever the heck it was that I was going to say?
we have a question right here. No, honestly, I love to talk about those issues, but I'm sure that the 99% here would be rolling their eyes if I took away time from the former prime minister. So another forum, another time, I promise. To the person with the microphone.
Good evening, it's Steve Pans here. I just listened to all these great questions this evening. I guess my father's always said, it's always about the youth. We have to invest in our youth for the future of Canada. So I'm looking at being a first-generation Canadian, and my children are growing up, and I look at how they reflect on the political scene. They're young in their 20s. It's not on their radar screen, and I guess I'm wondering, what can the government do, or what can we as parents or people in Canada do to instill the passion of this great land? And because we have a wonderful spot that we live in, and I guess it seems that we just haven't got... Maybe we have too many good things happening that it's not important in our life. It's status quo. But I'm trying to determine what is the question that the government can answer on how we can create a more positive passion in our young people to appreciate why it's important to be politically involved in what makes this country as great as it is.
I think that I'm not sure that I actually agree with your premise. I think that young people are very passionate about the country and about what they want to do. I spend a lot of time talking in universities, and I mean there are a lot of young people here who can really talk about it. But you know, I'll just tell you something. When I go into a university, and I'm asked to talk about 9 times out of 10, I'm asked to talk about the economy, and I do. And then at the end of it, I talk about something that I feel incredibly strongly about, which is the Aboriginal issue. And I find that in the question period, it just takes off, and the students really, really get into it, and they want to make a difference. The same thing if you go into a university and you talk about one thing and you raise the issue about Africa, or you raise the issue of foreign aid, or international affairs, or the leadership. The Arab Spring as an example, and it just takes off. I think that young people are every bit as passionate as we ever were, and I think they're really concerned. I think that there are a couple of differences. I think that they're a lot more worried about their economic situation than my generation certainly was, which is an understandable thing given what is going on, but I think that the passion to build the country, and the passion, even more importantly, to see the country represent the values that those students feel this country should hold and that we talk about, I think is there every bit as strong. And I think that what the government has to do is to essentially challenge them in the way in which we're going to accomplish that. I think that's part of the Aboriginal issue, by the way. I think it is to really say to them, okay, here it is, here's an issue, here are a group of people that have 8 times the suicide rate, have this huge incarceration rate, you know, what are we going to do jointly with them, not imposing it, or if we talk about our foreign affairs and that kind of thing. I guess my question, and maybe some of the young people here should come to it, I think your question's a really good one. I think that young people are every bit as passionate about building the country. It's up to government to try to figure out how to challenge them to basically carry that through.
So let me ask that as a follow-up question. We will go to the floor there in a second, but in a way that's what this is all about, is if there is that passion out there, how do your colleagues and former colleagues connect with that? How do you? I interviewed the Calgary mayor a few weeks ago, Nahid Nenshi, very impressive guy, and he says he's never run into anybody that's apathetic about city issues. Former Mayor Sam Sullivan would probably attest to this as well. The challenge for him is to make Calgarians feel like their government, municipal government, is listening to them and is acting on what they think. But what do you think in terms of drawing on that engagement that you hear from young people?
But I think you said it. I think you really said it. And I think that exactly what Max Cameron is doing. Yeah. I think tonight is. I mean, basically, what you do, you're setting up a center on democratic values. How do we make democracy work? I mean, I think that part of that answer is going to come from what this is. And I think that things like tonight, especially if you answer that Olga's question, I think are essentially going to create that. I think that the question is probably the key question, because the rest of us are going to be long gone, and they're the ones that are going to take over. And the real question is, how do we make sure that the passion that I think they feel is well channeled? I think that's right. And I think that's partially, I think what you're doing, Max, is going to be part of the answer, I hope.
Somebody's been very patient over here with the microphone, and you have your chance now to ask a question.
So I volunteer within a political party, and often we take stances on issues which the other side of the political spectrum will take the opposing view, and often it turns into demonizing the other side. So as Prime Minister, how did you stay true to yourself and not second-guess yourself when the other side of the spectrum was criticizing everything you did and making you seem like you were doing it for the wrong reasons?
The other side of the spectrum being the other political parties or within my own party?
Well, I was referring to the other parties.
let me tell you something. There are a number of people here. My political career was actually very heavily built on the Young Liberals. When I came in, I immediately identified with them, and they became most of my supporters. And in fact, it's a very interesting thing, but there are a number of the Young Liberals who were with me my whole political career or who are here tonight. Let me tell you, no longer young. And I think if I was giving any advice to a politician going in, that's exactly what I would do. I mean, young liberals are young people, I think, in a political party are the forces of change. They are the forces of dynamism. They are the forces that are going to drive a party. Some of the issues that they're going to come up with and some of their ideas aren't necessarily going to be timely. But the fact is that those, I think, are the issues that are really going to drive the country. And I think that a political party that is able to galvanize young people, and again, it goes back to the question that you had asked, I think a political party that is able to galvanize the greatest number of young people may not win the next election, but it sure as heck will win the one after. I could point out some of them. God, they've aged.
Well, that's the perfect place to bring this to a close before they rise up against you. Hold your applause, because Max is going to give the extra, but it's been a real privilege and pleasure to listen to you, and very happy that you've taken the time. Do you have a third topic that you want to bring up?
Yeah, no, I do. I just want to say two things. I want to go back to it. The question is really, how do we engage people? And I think what this is all about is engaging people. And I really want to congratulate the university for doing this. And I want to thank them for bringing me into this incredibly room. So thank you for that, Max. And I got to say, may I just say, and I think we should give, it's not an easy job being the moderator, asking the questions, being rude. And I think that you've done a tremendous job. And I'd like to just say congratulations. Well done.
Thank you very much. This has been a thought-provoking, passionate, inspiring conversation. And I think it's really not only set the tone for the kind of conversation that we want to stimulate here and in the center, but it really shows what can happen when we bring together leaders, students, academics, the media, to have these kinds of conversations. I just think there's enormous potential to enrich our collective lives. So thank you so much, Mr. Martin, for your time. And you too for the moderating. I'd also like to thank and to recognize our supporters who have made this possible. We couldn't have organized this event without the support of the McLean Foundation and CN, the sponsorship of the Vancouver Sun, the support of the CBC, the Peter Wall Institute. We're very grateful to them for their support. And we have a couple of gifts, I believe. A couple of gifts here from the Museum of Anthropology, and I believe that the PSSA, the Political Science Undergraduate Students, who have also been helping us to organize this, have also got a gift for Mr. Martin. So here you go. Here's the book.
Thank you.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Hi. Good. Thank you. Hello.
This is for you?
Yeah, we got your I Love Politics t-shirt.
That's great.
You guys have one as well?
Okay,
hold on.
Okay. Yeah. You gonna come in? All right. Thank you. All right.